So now we have a look at another, arguably even more interesting and indeed practically more important variant of tunneling, namely tunneling through a classically forbidden region. What we mean by this is sketched here for the potential. As always, this is the point where we start. So there is this region of an elevated potential energy. We call this a barrier. And now, classically, if a particle approaches this from either side with a total energy below this value, it will always be reflected. To be specific, we place a barrier between 0 and L, and then can write the potential down by specifying it in these three regions. For the quantum mechanical description, it is convenient to label the three regions, which I do here with the Roman numerals 1, 2, 3. We are interested in the case of the energy being below the potential energy in the barrier, so focus on this. With all our preparations, obtaining the solution isn't very difficult. We use the plane wave solutions in the region without potential, and in the region of the barrier, we use the real exponentials. The interpretation of the coefficients in regions 1 and 3 are just the same as we discussed in the previous example, so can be used to specify sources of incoming particles and then work out the transmission and reflection probabilities. In the barrier, we now have to keep both exponentials. We cannot rule them out by our boundary conditions, and we will indeed need them to satisfy the continuity conditions. These continuity conditions translate into boundary conditions between the regions. There, the potential energy is finite, so we have to require continuity also for the derivative of the wave function. At the first interface, this just looks like for the soft wall, including both coefficients of the exponentials in the barrier, which are multiplied by the imaginary part kappa of the wave number when we look at the derivative. And now we also encounter another interface between regions 2 and 3. There the conditions look a bit more involved, but this is simply because the way we place the barrier, so that now we have to evaluate the exponential function away from the origin. Looking at this, now we have four conditions for six coefficients, which gives us quite some freedom to look at different physical situations. So, to be specific, we again place our source to the very left, which means that B3 vanishes and A1 can be set to unity. So, the particle definitely arrives from the left with an amplitude fixed to a value that simplifies our expressions for the transmission and reflection probabilities. The following steps are really just algebraic manipulations. It isn't very instructive to use the time here in these videos, but it is a really good little exercise. One way to do this is to first use two conditions to eliminate the coefficients in the barrier, A2 and B2, and then to use the remaining ones to work out B1 and A3. And I give you the result for A3 here, which describes the transmission through the barrier. Now, in this case, the transmission probability is just the absolute value squared of A3. There's no extra factor because the wave numbers in regions 1 and 3 are the same. And so we get an explicit expression written down here. Most importantly, it is finite. So quantum mechanically, the particle can emerge on the other side of the barrier. As before, this will just occur randomly. Sometimes the particle will be reflected. We cannot know what will happen in each individual attempt, but at least we can work out the probability. The explicit expression at which we arrived is really instructive. The hyperbolic sign that appears in the denominator can be made very large by increasing L or kappa, and then the transmission probability becomes very small. So tunneling is rare through a very long barrier, and when you look at the expression for kappa, you also see that the barrier should not be too high, and the particle not too massive. And all of this is in relation to Planck's constant, which is a really small number in terms of normal quantities encountered in macroscopic contexts. So tunneling really occurs in your typical quantum system, such as for electrons moving through a semiconductor or in the context of nuclear decay. Finally, let us sketch the wave function, say again the real part. Here you see how the real exponentials help to mediate between the two regions. The emerging transmitted wave generally has a smaller amplitude because the transmission probability is finite, but generally not unity. Importantly, this does not mean a change of the energy of the particle. This whole situation here describes a stationary scenario where the energy is fixed. The intensity of the wave determines probabilities, not energies. So this was perhaps not that complicated. Hence, let us wrap up the discussion of these types of systems by pointing out how this all translates to more general situations. This will just be a qualitative discussion where we will fix the notions of bound states and extended states. We are guided by the following sketch of a relatively general potential. Here I indicate three important values, the global potential minimum and the asymptotic values of the potential to the very left and to the very right. Now, our general boundary conditions guarantee that we can only find so-called bound states below these asymptotic values. This is the region where energy quantization occurs, with the lowest state being the ground state, always with an energy above the global potential minimum. And above this, you find the excited states that also have discrete energies and wave functions that decay at very large distances. So these bound states are the solutions of the Schrödinger equation, where we then can take the wave function and convert it into a properly normalized probability density. And if we look at this, I choose a conveniently placed position of the horizontal axis so that we can nicely compare to the potential. We find that this can have these tails into some classically forbidden regions. For the example of the excited states sketched here, again with a conveniently chosen horizontal axis, we see that these tails can actually already mediate tunneling between different regions separated by a classically forbidden region. This can actually already occur in the ground state, it just depends on the potential. I also highlight the fact that in the excited states, the probability density generally oscillates, so you find nodes. Now, even further above this, we have the energies where the particle can escape to infinity. We call the states that we find there the extended states, and they exist at all these energies, so that energy quantization does not occur. In our examples, we saw that this happens because we then have fewer conditions, giving us also some choice to specify different physical scenarios. So in a general potential, we may have this situation here where there is a range of energies where the particle can only escape to one side. So coming from there, it will always be reflected. And above this, we have the energies where we can have both reflection and transmission. And this then can again involve tunneling through classically forbidden regions. The energetic values where we switch between the different scenarios are called energy thresholds. This picture also holds beyond one dimensions, where we then of course can escape into a whole range of other directions. And while I've sketched here a case with a finite potential minimum, this can also still work out if there are some singularities where the potential energy becomes infinite. We will see this in detail when we discuss the hydrogen atom, where we use the Coulomb potential and work in three dimensions. And just because I want to be precise and complete, I'd like to mention that there is actually a third type of state beyond the bound states and the extended states, which occurs when we deal with a random potential. And this is a really relevant case for electronic transport. There you can encounter so-called localized states in the region where we here have the extended states. The particle then actually does not escape to infinity, even though it could do so classically. So in some ways, this is the opposite of tunneling. The mathematics of these states is actually a little bit more complicated than what we do in this course. The phenomenon was discovered in 1958 by Phil Anderson, and he won the Nobel Prize for it in 1977. But using the scattering approach that I outlined earlier, it is actually not too bad, and you may even encounter it later in your degree. So this wraps up this part of our discussion. Next, we move on to the most important specific one-dimensional quantum system, the harmonic oscillator.